And welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the monastery, the open bar of the internet, the world's greatest shit show, and the place where we, the good brothers and sisters of this most holy of temples, seek enlightenment through the drunkest, craziest, most batshit ways possible. I am your one and only gaming monk, better known as Mildra, and normally during one of these I would say I have a newcomer to the temple, but that is not the case today. Welcoming straight back to the temple, head of the design mechanism, and one of the creators of Mythras, Lawrence Whitaker. How are you doing today, man? Or tonight?
Well, I'm obviously a willing re-sacrifice. So yeah, I'm not sure if I should feel welcomed or apprehensive. Maybe a bit of both. I'm very good, actually, Mildred. Thank you.
I have to, of course, cover myself by saying good afternoon and good evening because. Well, time zones.
I'm actually in the afternoon here. I'm in Canada, so I'm EST.
Okay, that's not as bad as some of the time zone conversions I've had to do over the last 2 months.
There you go. Making it easy on you.
Look, as long as I don't have to do any time zone conversions with Thailand or the Philippines, I think I'll be fine.
Okay.
No disrespect to the people of those nations, but I hate time zones. I will continue hating time zones until someone ties me down and stops me. But The last time I had you on, it was for the focus of casting the runes.
That's right. Yes.
And because of that, there were certain questions regarding some of the other output that the design mechanism has had that I wasn't able to focus on at that time.
Mm.
But the tradition that I've kind of developed since those early days, because that was one of the earlier interviews when I was still kind of developing the style that I would have. I mean, I had it for a bit, but it's been a lot. But I've had a lot more experience since then. What was your introduction to role playing games as a whole, and what was it that made it stick with you? Like, was your introduction through RuneQuest, or was it through something else?
No, it was through Tunnels and Trolls, funnily enough. And in fact, not really even that. I first heard about role-playing games when I read a magazine, one of the Sunday newspapers, and it got a sort of a focus on these funny games that didn't have an ending, could go on for days or weeks, and you played a role as a character. And it was D&D it was talking about. And I was sort of quite interested in that. I liked the pictures of the miniatures and so forth, and I sort of tried to make my own version of that with sort of model knights and whatever I could find, but it wasn't really a role-playing game. And then I stumbled across a magazine called The Gamer in the UK, which is a war games magazine, and that had a short article on role-playing games in there, and it had a solo adventure written by Ken St. Andre that ran across the bottom of the pages of the magazine. I played the shit out of that, and I loved it. It was my first introduction to having to create a character, having a combat system that used dice, and following a program thing where you made the choices. And it was a typical Ken St. Andre gonzo kind of adventure, but I was hooked from that point on. From there, I pestered and got Basic Dungeons & Dragons, the Purple Box set for Christmas that year. Mm-hmm. Loved D&D, managed to convince friends at school to play. From there, we kind of graduated to Traveller, which was sort of like, it seemed to be the path. You were a D&D player and a Traveller player, or you migrated from one to the other and kind of ran them in parallel. I decided to, I was a big reader of White Dwarf magazine, being in the UK. Mm-hmm. And I kept seeing, you know, references to the Player's Handbook and the Dungeon Master's Guide. So I saved up some money and went out and bought a copy of the DM's Guide, and was really shocked, disappointed, and crushed when I found that it wasn't the complete game. You know, I needed another couple of books, and it was adding layers of complexity in that I hadn't bargained on. You know, I thought it was just going to be something that would be an adjunct to Basic D&D and Expert D&D that I was playing. So I returned it to the shop, was given a credit note, and promptly bought RuneQuest. I'd seen scenarios in White Dwarf and articles and things, and it seemed like a completely different kind of beast, because it was all skill based. There were no increase in hit points, no levels, no classes, and that really kind of spoke to me. So I bought a copy of RuneQuest, the Games Workshop edition, and really never looked back from that. I didn't play very much D&D afterwards. It was all the Chaosium system, basic role playing, as we kind of know it, starting with RuneQuest. But really, things kicked in when I bought Stormbringer. I didn't really get into Glorantha as much in those early days. I was a very, very big Moorcock fan, and when I heard that they'd released a game based on the Elric stories that used the RuneQuest system, that was nirvana. So I rushed out to get a copy of Stormbringer as pretty much as soon as it was available in the UK, and that was, you know, my big introduction to the RuneQuest family of games.
It's funny you mentioned Elric, because if I'm not mistaken, the RuneQuest system has dipped into Elric's setting, I think, like at least three times over the years.
It's a couple of times where it's dipped into it. The Chaosium had the original license with Moorcock for producing his work. Moorcock also licensed or agreed to some licensing with TSR, and he allowed the I think they said, can we include the Elric mythos in Deities and Demigods? And he agreed to it, not realizing that it was going to cause problems with Chaosium. So there was some sort of wrangling there. But no, Chaosium had the license to Stormbringer for quite a long time. It then transferred over to Mongoose when Mongoose resurrected RuneQuest sort of around the mid-2000s. And they developed their own version of the game, which I was heavily involved in developing. And they kind of had it up until quite recently, and now the license is with a French company that have a game called Mournblade, and it doesn't use the basic role-playing system. I haven't played it, I haven't seen a copy, but I do know it's not a traditional BRP based game. It's it uses a different system.
Yeah, I remember hearing about Mournblade, but I never was able to look too deep into it. If you had to guess, why do you think that particular IP was so long lasting within the family of basic role playing?
That's a difficult one to answer, because for a long time Stormbringer kind of languished with very little support from Chaosium, mainly because Stormbringer, it was quite niche, didn't really sell very many copies. And it's amazing now to see how many people come out of the woodwork and go, hey, that was one of my first games, loved it, played the hell out of it. You wouldn't have known it at the time. The number of Stormbringer players that were around was actually very, very small. I think Chaosium just sort of wanted to hold on to that license for as long as they could, on the off chance that they would find themselves in a position that they could do something with it. Moorcock himself was not happy with how the license was handled. There was some disputes over royalties. There were some disputes over the way certain things were produced. So in the end, I think it was agreed with all concerned that, it should go to somebody that would manage things better. And Chaosium sort of let it go onto Mongoose. I don't know the precise nature of that deal itself. Yeah. But Mongoose tried to sort of revive it, and it kind of went the same way. There were a few supplements for it, most of which I was involved with. But again, it was never a vast seller. It never sold in the numbers that their Traveller stuff did, or Mongoose's versions of Paranoia, or even any of their D20 books. So, Michael Moorcock, he's sort of in the mid-70s and very early 80s, you could go into any bookshop and there'd be an entire shelf or two would be dominated by Moorcock's books. You go in there now, you see none of them. It's time's moved on, and it's kind of a shame in a way. But there is a small hardcore group of Stormbringer and Elric and sort of Eternal Champion fans out there, and they keep the flame alive. So I hold out hope that people will be playing Moorcock-based games for some time to come.
Yeah. Now I will freely admit that my path towards the Young Kingdoms was some would argue a little bit heretical because of how I got into it, because I was a big fan of the Legacy of Kain games. I still am. I've been keeping a close eye on what Dennis Dyack is working on in the future with Deadhouse Sonata. And through that, one of my friends told me about the fact that a lot of the stuff that was from the Legacy of Kain games he had argued ripped off. I try and be a little more hesitant about using that particular phrase, but he brought up the Elric books. And eventually the whole Eternal Champion thing, and that was how I found out about it. And then through that, now Stormbringer and Elric with an exclamation point, I missed out on initially. My first introduction to those when it came to them as RPGs was through the Mongoose run, Elric of Melnibone.
Yep.
I'm probably I'm sure someone could argue that I'm mispronouncing it, but that's how
you pronounced it correctly. I'm in awe. Most people say Melnibone. It's Melnibony.
Mm-hmm. I credit it with having to do with a lifetime of kind of funny names, let's say.
Yeah, there's a distinct accent on that.
There's been plenty of accents that I've had to deal with, but as I recall correctly from my research, before it was known as Mythras, Mythras was the sixth edition of RuneQuest.
That's right.
Talk to me about how the company, the design mechanism, got started, because that was the first I had heard of the company was through that.
Mm-hmm. Pete Nash and I were the core of the design mechanism. We both worked for Mongoose. We were both line writers for them. I'd been a line writer since about 2006, and Pete joined a couple of years later. And we were heavily involved in developing the direction of the RuneQuest license that they had. The first edition of RuneQuest that Mongoose published was not well received. It was not well put together. There were some very good bits in there. There were some very admirable bits, and there were some that just sucked completely. And so what Pete and I were tasked with doing was rewriting the game so that it was more coherent, it made sense, and it better reflected, you know, the heritage of what was going on. So we did that, and it was published as Mongoose RuneQuest 2. And it was actually quite short-lived. I think it was in print for a couple of years before it became clear that I think Mongoose were having challenges in really marketing the book. So sales were falling, and they decided that they were going to sunset the license. So it reverted back to Isseries, which is Greg Stafford's company at the time. And Greg contacted us. We contacted Greg when we found out that the license was changing hands, and we said, look, we've done all this work. We'd really like to continue it. We'd like to continue, you know, as custodians of the RuneQuest brand. And Greg took the chance on it, and we ended up having to form our own company and rewriting what was Mongoose RuneQuest 2 to become the sixth edition of RuneQuest. And so what we tried to do was to sort of capture some of the old heritage of, you know, the fond heritage that the first and second editions of Chaosium's RuneQuest had, mm-hmm. but obviously with the new mechanics that we developed while we were working for Mongoose. We resigned from Mongoose sometime before the license actually changed. So that was really the beginning of it all. We formed it to publish RuneQuest. We were convinced that we could do as good a job as Mongoose had been doing with it. We got a lot of support from Greg and from various people that worked with him, like Moon Design Publications, Rick Mites, Jeff Richard, and Neil Robinson in particular. Mm-hmm. And we kind of developed it from there. So we had that license for 5 years.
Now, of course through that it went through its own bits of iterations and a handful of some familiar types of campaign settings, and also some that were most definitely different. But before I get into that, one thing I'm curious about is, when you're sitting down to say, okay, we're working on this new edition, what were some of the things that you wanted to focus on adding, and what were some of the things that you wanted to try and address from previous editions?
We wanted a game that was going to be internally consistent throughout, something that was elegant, well thought through, well designed, and hung together in ways that you could easily separate out different things if you didn't like them. But if you wanted to play it as a whole, it would work pretty seamlessly across. So there's a very carefully worked out design ethos throughout the whole of RuneQuest 6, or Mythras as it is now. And you know, we developed those rules and the mechanisms, such as the combat system, the various magic systems, the character creation systems. We developed those quite carefully over about 10 years. This wasn't something that we sat down and plotted out just for RuneQuest 6. We'd been working on these iteratively for a long time, Pete and I. We'd been involved in the playtesting for Kasim's BRP Big Gold Book, as it was known. And some of those things that we'd done in that playtest kind of came into being for the work we were doing with Mongoose RuneQuest. So that was really the essence of it. We wanted to make mechanically a game that was solid all the way through. Most games have weaknesses in certain areas, and you know, Mythras is not perfect. It's got its own weaknesses too. But I think by and large, we have got the rules where we really, really like them. Mm-hmm. So they are solid. They're very, very flexible. They're very forgiving in certain areas where they weren't forgiving beforehand. They offer a different experience, certainly in combat. RuneQuest's combat has always been innovative, because it was designed by people that had experience through the SCA of armed fighting. But with the work we did, we wanted to kind of get away from the I hit you, parry, oh no you don't, let's do damage and hey, I've just lost an arm kind of trope that it's become associated with. We wanted it so that, first of all, things were more cinematic. If you wanted to replicate a Jedi Knight duel, you could do it with these mm-hmm. rules. If you wanted to have a really gritty kind of Game of Thrones hacking and thrusting sword fight with limbs being lopped off, you can do that. Or if you wanted something that was swashbuckling in the Errol Flynn style, you could do that too. And to do that, what you've got to do is kind of break down the way that combat really works, which is all based around hit point attrition traditionally in RuneQuest. You know, you're trying to get that guy's hit points down to the point where he falls over and dies or can't fight anymore. We introduce the special effects, which are really at the heart of our version of the combat system, so that you could end a fight without having to do that. And that was tested over, you know, a long period of time and tuned and tweaked to get it to a point where you genuinely can have a very, very exciting, tactical, realistic fighting experience, as much as anything can be a realistic in a role-playing game. Mm-hmm. And it felt different to how RuneQuest combats often felt. Often in RuneQuest combats, you've got two high-powered fighters slugging it out, and it can go on forever and ever and ever. With ours, with RuneQuest 6 and Mythras, fights tend to be over pretty quickly, and it's not because the other side is out of hit points. It's because they can't fight back anymore. They're either prone, disarmed, bleeding out, fatigued, or you've got them pinned down with a sword at their throat and they've got no alternative but to surrender. So we were looking really to create a different ethos with the game to how it had been. But you know, we can't ignore the fact that the work that was done on the original RuneQuest was groundbreaking, and it set everything up that we have then developed.
Mm-hmm. Now, one of the things that definitely stuck with me and I covered this in the review, that I thought was very unique and very inspired, even though I had a couple nitpicks with it, was the replacement of weapon skills with fighting styles.
Mm-hmm.
Because when it comes to a lot of skill-centric games, there I often see the tendency of having every weapon as its own individual skill, but instead you went with the fighting styles. What I'm curious about is what was the mindset behind doing that particular change, and was it one that was met with resistance?
I don't think it was ever met with resistance. I think people met it with a certain sense of incredulity when they first saw it. But I think those that kind of have stuck with it and used it kind of grasp what the Premise is. The Premise is very simple. It's realistic. This, if you train as a fighter, and you know, typically a melee fighter with a sword and a shield or a spear and or whatever, and Pete Nash does. You know, he is a very skilled martial artist in that respect. You don't train in one weapon. You don't learn your sword and your shield independently. You work with them together. You learn how to move, how to use your shield and your sword as weapons in their own right, but functioning as a unit. If you're a hoplite, mm-hmm. you're going to learn how to use your sword, your spear, and your shield in different combinations. So it makes sense to treat the combat skills as a fighting style that are defined by the role that you're in, rather than being individual weapons that you just happen to have a competency about. So that was the real impetus for that. It was to really sort of replicate how trained warriors really are trained. You know, even now in the military, you know, you when you go through training, you're going to be trained with a sidearm. You're going to be trained in a certain degree of hand-to-hand combat. You're going to be trained in some stealth tactics as well. Mm-hmm. And that's no different to how combat styles have been trained throughout the ages. So that's what we wanted to replicate in RuneQuest 6 and Mythras.
Yeah. And to be honest, when I say nitpicks, I think the only thing that I said it could have used was just a few more examples so it could show what it's capable of.
I completely agree, you know. And in hindsight, it's something that we will definitely address better in future iterations. And you know, not to plug it gratuitously, but we're about to release the Leoness role-playing game, which is based on the Mythras system. And we've done exactly that. We've given some very concrete examples of a combat style for this kind of culture. And it's much better defined than it was in the original versions of the game. So completely accept and take on that point, and mm-hmm. it's a point well made.
Yeah, especially since part of the reason I focus on something like that is because I'm a major advocate for making non-magic encounters interesting. A lot of it is my reaction to frustrations with how, like, I grew up watching old black and white film of Zorro or Three Musketeers or that kind of stuff, and wanting to implement these sort of elaborate fights, but all that I had was just Beck Me D&D, and every time I try and do that, I'd either have to come up with whole new things myself, or I just couldn't do it, and meanwhile there's the whole spell bloat problem, which where you've got half a dozen pages of potential spells for the casters, and the non-casters are doing the same damn thing every single round.
Yeah, very little variation. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think we agree with you as well. We wanted combat to be tactically interesting, to introduce some new elements that to a certain extent been in RuneQuest combat and in other game systems as well, but make them simpler to access, not based around penalties to hitting or defending, which is kind of the typical way. You know, you want to aim for someone's head, you can do it, but it's X penalty. Well, why? If you're a trained fighter, that's probably what you've been trained in, so why penalize it? So we came up with the mechanism so that you could trigger a special effect on a standard skill roll that would allow you to get access to these additional things as well as traditional damage.
Mm-hmm. And I think the other aspect when it comes to it, and I will correct myself slightly in the fact that there is some degree of attempt to help out with that whole examples thing in the combat cards thing. I just couldn't cover that at the time because I'd end up breaking one of my rules. When I'm covering a core book, I have to cover everything that's in that book. Any extra stuff I can't talk about.
And you know, that's absolutely a fair point as well.
But it when it comes to that, I think something else that definitely helps is the fact that one, there isn't the same stuff problem, and I'd say this is something that RuneQuest has been pretty consistent on. Like you look at the more traditional approaches, and you've got this huge list of spells that everybody's supposed to be picking from, and they're all going to be cast, and no matter what, they're going to be casting them in the same way, which never made sense to me. Like, I hate to pick on D&D with all this, but it is a victim of its own traditions, and I'm an equal opportunity roaster, but you've probably had to ask yourself the question, why are clerics and druids using the same list of spells? but when it came to that, one thing I'm curious about is you mentioned Jedi. Now, was the rules for mystic types, was that designed specifically for accompanying that with the whole talent based approach that it has compared to the other powers?
No, not really. It was originally designed for a shared world project that Pete and I were involved in called Gwenthia, which predated all the work that we'd been doing for Mongoose by a few years, but was instrumental in developing a lot of the mechanisms like combat effects and the magic systems that found their way into RQ. In this shared world Gwenthia, there were a number of different cultures that had mystic rites, a lot of Gnosticism and sort of transcendental religious things based around the religion of that world, and we wanted a magic system that would reflect, you know, attaining some kind of inner harmony and having supreme control over your ability to do X, Y, and Z. And we were probably more influenced by the Wuxia films like Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon, and some of the other things, more so than Star Wars. So mysticism actually has its roots there, and the whole idea of the talents and unlocking, being able to do things at a greater skill level easier came from that approach, and we translated it over to RuneQuest, and we actually used the Jedi example as for combat more than for mysticism. When we were developing things for Mongoose for the second edition of their RuneQuest iteration, you know, we said we want to do this with a combat system. It's going to be fantastic. We had to convince Matt Sprange, the director of Mongoose, that it would live up to those claims. So we showed him how you could replicate a lightsaber duel from The Phantom Menace with force pushers and, you know, leaping up and spinning around in the air and all this kind of thing, deflecting laser blasts using the combat system, and it worked, and he was sold on that. And then kind of the mysticism magic rules, it's very much in the if you train you can unlock these special abilities that are innate to everybody, which is very much kind of the Jedi ethos. So it's more probably a happy accident than it being a deliberate design decision to be able to do Jedi with Star Wars, but it had a very different birthplace.
Now, Something that I've found kind of amusing is when it comes to the settings that people have used as a kind of jumping on point with Mythras. Now some of them already had a strong foundation because they had been touched upon in previous editions, like stuff like Mythic Britain, Mythic Rome, all that kind of stuff. But then there are ones that introduced me to material that I was not aware of at all. One of them being Luther Arkwright.
Mm-hmm.
Like when I found out about that through the books, and I had no idea that that was a graphic novel beforehand.
then my work is done. that is fact. We have accomplished exactly what we wanted to do when we picked that license up. That is exactly what we were after, to introduce people to, you know, Luther Arkwright's a very British kind of science fiction or science fantasy. And certainly in North America, it doesn't always translate in the way that the British people have a love for that kind of quirky, kind of dark, sort of semi-psychedelic feel to it. We definitely wanted to ship that across the pond. That was definitely part of the reason why we approached Brian Talbot to see if the game rights were available. First, because we absolutely adore Luther Arkwright. He was, you know, he was a homage to the Eternal Champion, like Jerry Cornelius. Mm-hmm. So he sort of fits within that whole oeuvre that's always interested me and Pete. If we have managed to broaden the audience for Brian Talbot's work and creations, fantastic. Job done.
And
that really warms my heart to hear that.
I would actually argue that now... I will admit that I am not the best sample for a test audience, because myself and several other people at my table are fans of Red Dwarf, along with a few other works. So when it comes to British SF, I'm not going to claim that we're experts, but we're not exactly spring chickens about it.
That's good. You had a head start.
And I will admit I may have made at least one or two rogue type characters who were a bit of an homage to Cat, because I liked him, because I liked Cat.
Yeah, great character.
Although the whole Mr. Flibble thing became a running gag as well, because somebody said that there's no way you can make a hand puppet scary. yes you can. But I think that particular style of science fiction is especially relevant nowadays, and that's not me making a lead into how certain titans of American SF have been pooing in the loo for the last few years, but more to do with the fact that I've been seeing a reaction to what a good friend of the show has referred to as big men with screwdrivers.
Big men with screwdrivers.
Yeah.
Okay.
He and several others that I know have been very critical of the emphasis on having technical people solving technical problems in science fiction, and not enough emphasis on the characters, which is where he came up with the term "big men with screwdrivers."
Right. Okay.
And you look at something like that in that There's a lot of crossover between that and just old school pulp in general, and that's why I think that these days I would probably make a greater push to recommend the Arkwright graphic novels more than I might have say 10 years ago.
I think you got to remember that. Let's go. Just to go back to Michael Moorcock, he was never really a big science fiction fan, or really a massive fantasy fan. He was trying to break down the conventions of the genres that he was writing in, and his autobiography or semi autobiography that was released a couple of years ago. He goes into some detail about his attitudes towards science fiction at the time, mm-hmm. and that's why he founded New Worlds and so forth. And it was very much anti science fiction. It wasn't about, you know, physics of space travel or whatnot. It was very much around the political dimensions, the social sexual dimensions, the way that society was going to be changed as we sort of have more technology just upon us and new ways of thinking. So he was very much against that big men with screwdrivers approach anyway. And Brian Talbot with Luther Arkwright was, again, part of that kind of counterculture movement that enjoyed the tropes of science fiction, but it was actually more grounded in, you know, the characterization of it. And so I think that's quite a valid point, that the characters and the stories that emerge from the characters and their interplay with their environment is what's at the heart of that strand of science fiction and science fantasy, as opposed to the hard SF of, you know, the likes of Larry Niven or you know, Greg Bear or David Brin and all that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm. And to that end, one of the other ones that ended up sparking my attention, simply because it was taking a very unique approach to a trope that I was very familiar with, especially having grown up in the 90s. Which I know is probably breaking a lot of disappointment that I'm not as old as some people think I am.
I'm shocked. I'm shocked.
Yeah, I will set up the fainting couch later. but the one setting from Mythras that fascinated me because of that whole new spin was after the Vampire Wars.
Mm-hmm.
Now, given the time that I grew up, I came into the whole vampire mythos in the aftermath of films like The Lost Boys, which,
yeah,
incidentally, is a very underrated film. But that film, one could argue, is the patient zero for the whole urban vampire motif, mm-hmm, that would persist for years and still persist for better and for worse to this day. But with something like after the Vampire Wars, we have the notion of how governments would respond to this sort of thing. But also the fact that this is after shit is at the fan and people are starting to adjust to this degree of normal to a certain extent. There's still the whole war in the shadows, just not as blatant as it was in the past. And what I'm curious about when it comes to that is, now that was. Now, that was developed by Sneed. Was that something that he approached you guys with, and how did it come about?
So John had written After the Vampire Wars for Basic Roleplaying when it was he pitched it to Chaosium, and they published it in its first edition. So it used the Basic Roleplaying system. Mm-hmm. So he'd always written it with a D100 system in mind. The game had kind of gone into abeyance. The rights had reverted back to John, and there was some discussion on RPGNet about what's happening with After the Vampire Wars. Someone speculated, "Hey, this would be a great fit for Mythras," and you know, someone said to John, you should get in touch with them. And John said, well, you know, I'm a lot on my plate, but if they want to get in touch, happy to talk. So I saw this and reached out to him. And that was it. We quickly agreed to do a new version for Mythras. And I gave John complete creative control over what he wanted to do with that and how he wanted to sort of mold the rules so it would fit After the Vampire Wars, mm-hmm, given that it is a very different genre to the ones that we'd done, you know, Mythic Britain, Mythic Rome, and so forth. This was, you know, very much contemporary. But yeah, it's not that far removed from Luther Arkwright. And you've got a lot of the same tropes in there. And in fact, the world of After the Vampire Wars could be a Luther Arkwright parallel. So it really wasn't that much of a huge leap for us, setting-wise. A lot of the the mechanics for, you know, vehicles, and the modern world had already been developed for Arkwright. And it was kind of a natural thing to extend it over to after the Vampire Wars. And then John developed the magic systems, the psychic systems, and the various other things that you see in there now. So it was a very good fit.
Yeah. Would it be fair when it comes to a large amount of the material that I often see for both RuneQuest and for Mythras, a lot of it has very much a fantasy bent to it. Mm-hmm. Now I know that basic role playing has tackled other genres in science fiction and the like, but would you say that it's relatively easy or relatively tricky to adapt Mythras' material into science fiction?
It's not difficult at all. I think it's pretty easy as long as you know what you're doing. It's like anything. What the RuneQuest and the basic role-playing system really gives you is a very flexible framework. You've got some traditional statistics, a bunch of skills, whatever they are called, with a very simple mechanic attached to it. That lends itself to any genre you really want to care about. There are limitations and breakpoints with the roll under system, given that you've got a 1-to-100 scale, and going above that can be tricky at times, but there are ways around it. There are ways that you can develop power bases that will scale to higher levels. There are different ways of approaching the subject matter, so that if you do want to play, to give you a good example, Pete Nash has often run games set in Ian Banks' culture universe, which has ships the size of small cities with brains that exist in hyperspace. And we've played ships, you know, these great space-bound godlike beings, very successfully. And all you need to do is just adapt to the mechanics to fit that level of play. But it's still, you know, basic role-playing, roll-under that we're using. We still use special effects in combat. They're just different effects. It's eminently flexible. It's perfectly capable of doing all those things. And Chaosium proved it when they released Worlds of Wonder. You had Magic World, Superworld, and what was the other one that's in there? Future World. All in that one box, using a unified system. From that, it spawned Ringworld, which again was adapted to its subject matter, and very successfully too. You may not like some of the mechanics, but the way that it implemented them kind of fit very much with Larry Niven's hard science fiction universe. So yeah, it can absolutely do all those things.
I often talk about the fact that not all game systems are created equal, which is something that a lot of people think. I mean, I've had my fair share of stories where somebody will point to a TV show or an anime or a tokusatsu series that they enjoy and come to me and say, how would I do this in D&D? And I would say, well, the first thing I would do is not use D&D.
Not use D&D.
But there is that mindset of using just this one system for everything. And unless you're doing a truly universal approach, you're going to eventually hit a wall, or you're going to be house ruling to the point where you may as well just make a new game yourself. Are there any genres or play styles that you can think of that Mythras would be a trickier fit for? Not to say incompatible, just one that would require a bit more legwork.
Yeah, certainly something like Ghostbusters. I wouldn't use Mythras for, you know, the point there is not to have special effects in combat and the ability to lop limbs off or detailed sorceress magic systems. You know, it's very light, very funny, designed to move quickly. And Greg Stafford did that when, you know, he developed the Ghostbusters game for West End. It was very much designed to replicate the fun and playfulness of those films, and did it brilliantly. So that's a good example of where the mechanics were tuned to a certain genre and to replicate a certain kind of experience. Tune, another one, fantastic. Mm-hmm. Very simple mechanics. You could never really do. You could do it with basic role playing or with Mythras, but would it be as much fun? Probably not. So I think that there's lots and lots of different genres, and you know, even specific books that you would think, yeah, I'd actually use, you know, Fate for that, because the way it approaches the subject matter is the way that this works. So no, Mythras has certainly its own limitations. There are some things you wouldn't be able to do with it, and it's probably better to go with a system that's been developed with that kind of approach in mind. So yeah, I completely agree that not all games are made equal, and it'd be a pretty poor world if they were, actually.
As far as making them all equal, you wouldn't get an RPG, you'd get a poor man's LARP. No disrespect to LARP players, I love you guys, but again, equal opportunity roaster.
Here's the way I approach it. I love trying new game systems. Although I said that I haven't played much D&D, and that is true. I kind of left D&D behind. I'm playing in a 5th edition campaign with my gaming group here in Toronto, and yeah, we're about to give Dungeon Crawl Classics a try. I've tried Powered by the Apocalypse. I've tried Into the Odd. I've tried loads of different game systems, and I love trying them. To me, there's always something in a game that recommends itself, and I'm all for learning about how other writers and other game developers have approached a certain problem, what systems they've created or adapted to meet that challenge, and then how they've implemented it in play. Sometimes mechanics are incredibly simple but very effective, like the advantage dice in D&D 5th edition. So simple, yet really effective. I'm surprised that nobody had really come along with that before. I always find something in a role-playing system that I really enjoy, some more than others, but there's usually something to recommend them. And I think that's fantastic. And, you know, it doesn't matter if your preference is for, you're a dyed-in-the-wool D&D 5th edition player. There's probably something in Pathfinder or something in Call of Cthulhu or something in Mythras that you think, oh, yeah, that's really cool. I wonder if that would work with these mechanics in that way. That's how games developed. That's how RuneQuest developed. It was Steve Perrin playing D&D and taking the thief skill rules and expanding them to cover all the classes. So all he was doing was adapting stuff that had already been developed. D&D itself came from its wargaming background with initiative to hit armor classes and so forth. Mm-hmm. So everything has been an iterative response to what's gone before or is going on in parallel. And I think you can learn from something. You know, never sneer at another game system. Always sort of see what it's got to offer. Play it, give it a go. You may not like it. It may not fit your play style. But at least you've had a crack at it. And at least you can say from an informed position, yeah, I like that because it did this. I didn't like that because it did it in this way. And that's just as true of Mythras as it is of anything else.
Yeah. Now, when it comes... Now, The one type that I will freely admit I never thought I would see regarding Mythras' system is the idea of superhero through something like Agony and Ecstasy, even though that was a a self-contained adventure.
Yeah.
Do you think that Mythras's framework could support a full-on superhero thing, or would it be tricky to accompany the powers that you'd need for supers?
No, it's perfectly able to do it. I mean, that was proved in the Superworld system anyway. I mean, you know, Superworld had a pretty decent following when it was first released. No, it can absolutely do superheroes. I mean, what are magic systems but superpowers? They're just tied into a certain kind of genre. So, yeah, of course it can do it. And what you need is an ability. You need a mechanic that is designed to reflect the genre, which is what we've been talking about already. Mm-hmm. And Mike Larrimore and Brian Pivik, who are the two guys that are working on the superhero game that we're developing, Destined, have done just that. Mike Larrimore came up with the idea of having, you know, rather than trying to think of every single superpower that you can, just think of a core set, and then have a range of things that he calls boosts that you can buy in tandem with those that make that core power behave differently. And that's how you can then get super speed versus sort of flash-like versus someone that can fly like Superman. It's how you can have someone that's got the strength powers of the Hulk that can take on a character that's a combat expert like Daredevil or Batman. And so the core mechanic for handling those superpowers is thought it through very carefully. He's playtested the hell out of it. He's adapted it a number of times to make sure that it reflects different levels of play, from sort of street level superheroes kind of up to about the Avengers level. And it works very, very well. He freely admits that when you get into sort of godlike powers like Thor or Superman, and so on, you're going to have some challenges. So we set a very definite ceiling and made sure that the power system works in an efficient, effective, we hope, original way to how it's previously been done. And it's exactly how we approach anything else. Mysticism, magic, sorcery, animism. Try and find a different spin on it and find the mechanics that will convey and be truthful to the genre, but will also work with the core basis of the Mythras engine. So yeah, mm-hmm. Absolutely it can do superheroes, and I think it's going to do it really, really well.
Now, when it came to the whole concept with classic fantasy, one thing that I was curious about with that is how much of stuff like the OSR were you channeling through that, because I remember reading through it and for whatever reason my mind kept coming back to Dungeon Crawl Classics.
It's not really influenced by Dungeon Crawl Classics and the OSR as a movement as such. It is Rodney Leary, the developer of Classic Fantasy. It's his love letter to Advanced D&D. He still adores and still has an AD&D campaign going on. He loves the way that the classes work together. You know, the spells that you found in traditional three book D&D, the one that I returned to get RuneQuest. He's still very much immersed in that, still very much in love with that. And that's what he's designed Classic Fantasy to be able to replicate, again, with appropriate tweaks and adjustments so that it works with the BRP engine. Mm-hmm. So it's not really a conscious attempt to be part of the OSR movement, because as I understand it, that really is around using the AD&D and the, you know, the BCM mechanics and framework to create, you know, a new version of those that sort of familiar style of plays. It's not designed to do it in that way, so I don't see it as an OSR game. Mm-hmm. But yeah, it's definitely there to recreate the AD&D experience, but using the BRP rule set.
Yep. Now, sometime after I had found out about Mythras, I inevitably ended up stumbling into a far future take known as M Space. And in that, one of the labels that I found on the thing was Mythras Gateway. What exactly is that gateway stamp?
So the gateway is a compatibility stamp. We have a license that you can apply for if you want to use the Mythras core rules to power your own game. It's free. You know, you don't pay us any royalties, but we want to sort of have a certain amount of approval just to make sure that, first of all, no one's going to go away and make Fatal with the Mythras rules. That's primarily what it's there for. But we also want to make sure that there's a certain degree of quality control. It's recognizably a Mythras base game. So essentially that's what the license does. It has some certain restrictions in there, but there's a lot of flexibility. And you know, I've just signed a license today for a really interesting Mythras Gateway product that I think is going to be pretty exciting, which is transdimensional and all kinds of wonderful and wacky things. But really what it's there to do is to kind of communicate the brand. We put a lot of work into building Mythras up as a gaming brand. We like to think we've been pretty successful at it, and we're quite well respected. So we're flattered when people say we'd like to use your game system. How can we do it? So that's what the gateway is there to support.
All right, that makes sense. Now, when it came, it's definitely similar to some other takes. And I'm just gonna put this out there right now. Dramatic reading of Fatal. I will only do that if I get 10,000 subs. Okay, that should cover me for a few years. But God help me if that ever happens and I have to read through Fatal. I'm pretty sure by then you'll find me.
I think you just have to read that infamous review that was on RPG and it tells you everything you need to know.
Oh yeah, the one by Sarton and McLennan. I might contact a friend of mine so I don't have to suffer it alone and just do a dramatic reading of that. Especially since doing a reading of a book that's 900 pages long would probably kill me. but when it comes to Mythras, I'm admittedly curious about is the notion of fighting techniques and more schools of abilities in the vein of say exalted charm trees or something like that, although not as insane as those charm trees because that can go for a while. But like say the advancing sword magic abilities that were in the infamous Book of Nine Swords, is that something that could be compatible with Mythras with a bit of work?
I'm really not familiar with that, so I really don't know what you're talking about. If you can give me a more concrete example, perhaps I can answer the question.
The whole idea with the Book of Nine Swords was a group of weapon schools that all had this pool of leveled techniques, like Desert Wind had a lot of flaming sword and a lot of wind sword kind of effects throughout its various tiers, and had some weapons that it implemented. It's one of those things where it'd be curious whether that would fall under sorcery or mysticism.
It's an interesting one. I think it would fall under several different areas. Common magic or folk magic could do a certain level of that. Sorcery could do it too. Mysticism is, it's not really about empowering objects with powers. It's more about realizing and unlocking the potential within yourself. So it's more of a personal magic system. But there's no reason why you couldn't have a school of master swordsmen that have a mystical approach and also know a certain degree of common magic, so they can have, you know, a blade sharp spell and a fire blade perhaps stacked together on the same weapon, because they know how to handle that. So I think you could find an approach in that using the existing magic systems that we have without too much difficulty. But I think there would come a point where you would have to do a lot of work around the ethos and you know, how those powers are going to scale and what's going to be available at these higher tiers, as it were. But certainly I think it's doable. I think Mythras magic, any of the magic systems, has the capability of sort of going up, you know, several notches to reach, you know, really sort of uber powered heights.
Mm-hmm. And that's another thing. I've been trying to figure out how something like RuneQuest could handle that sort of Gonzo level high powered, and the only thing that comes to mind is maybe messing with degrees of success, a la Death Watch, especially since that's also using a D100 approach. But even that's a bit of a stretch. It's just one of those things, because you can't have somebody with a strength of 100, because then they're almost never going to fail a roll. But do you think there's the even though the term mythic is used with a lot of the books, do you think there is the possibility of doing that kind of mythic level play where characters are budding demigods,
where you're kind of really into some of the Steve Erickson stuff with some of the uber powered characters that you get in that? Mm-hmm. Yes, again, I think it's a question of making sure that you've tailored the systems to reflect that style of play. Out of the box, you may struggle at certain points, so you would probably have to sit down and look at how you needed the mechanics to work and find an appropriate scaling mechanism for them.
Now, I think one of the other things that I'm curious about when it comes to Mythras, when it came to it, has there ever been any consideration of putting in rules so that people could create custom weapons and armor? I know that there's a good amount of customization when it comes to the equipment out of the box, but was that ever something that was considered?
Well, it's already in there. You know, there are rules for creating things and you know, even enchanting things. Mm-hmm. But you know, if you want to make a sword, you can have craft weaponsmith. Mm-hmm. There's a skill, and you can go out and make that sword. There are enhancement rules for seeing how good it is, how much it will be worth. So, all those are in there. You know, we have rules for, we kept the even things like the armor rules reasonably flexible, so that if you want tortoise shell armor, made from a giant turtle, you can do that quite easily. It's we have rules for exotic armor substances, and we do it ourselves in lots of the supplements, especially in something like Monster Island, where we adapt quite a lot of the basic rules and take them a couple of steps further to replicate the kind of really weird society that there is on that island, with lizard men and ophidians, with sorcery and animism, with really weird creatures and everything that wants to kill you. So, it's perfectly all doable straight out of the book. I don't think we need to create any additional rules to support that. That isn't to say that others may, you know, want to do it in a slightly different way, or bring in rules and ideas from other systems where it's geared to doing more of that, and that's perfectly fine. But we don't feel a need to create a full supplement. We don't need an arms and equipment book for Mythras, in my view.
Yeah. It's just one of those things that came to mind because I can think of a certain person who would be bugging me from here to Kingdom Come that he wants his fighter to have a Batleth.
It's a great sword, you know, to take the statistics for a great sword and muck about with them a bit. Mm. You know, its reach is going to be slightly different. Maybe it's got a couple of different special effects that it's got access to, but hell, you know, it's a big, heavy blade that's wielded two-handed in a certain technique. It's perfectly doable.
I'm very much in favor of getting people to go to shift away from thinking that they have to go sword and board. Nothing against the whole concept of sword and board, but in my not so humble opinion, it is the most boring way to equip a character.
It might be the safest way to equip them, though. Depends what you want that character mm-hmm. to do.
Well, it's more of an issue of it being the assumed standard. Like just because you're playing a fighter or a knight doesn't mean that you should assume that that's the way that you should be equipping. And I've seen that happen a lot, where somebody before they even consider their fighting style, they're already thinking, okay, I'm going sword and board. There was one case where somebody was playing a knight and that's what they wanted to do, and I'm like, are you sure, or do you think that's going to fit the character, especially since in this case he was more of a black knight. I was like, you sure you don't want to go with something that's a little bit more dirty fighting, you know, like maybe throw in a flail.
All the tools are in Mythras to be able to replicate, you know, differing styles like that. Yeah, sword and board is perfectly acceptable if you want that, you know, the optimum balance between good protection and the ability to protect multiple locations simultaneously, mm-hmm. and a weapon that's going to be able to do a decent range of different things at a given reach and distance. But if you want to play someone like Monty Python's Black Knight with a huge, great claymore, clad in incredibly heavy plates, so you are literally lumbering around the battlefield, but when you hit something it doesn't get up again, the rules perfectly support all of that. All you need is the combat style, the weapons defined within that combat style, and they're entirely up to you. And this is why we, going back to what we're saying about examples in the book, one of the reasons we didn't put too many examples in the book is people take that as gospel and they think, ah, right, that combat style is always going to have those four weapons in it and that combat trait. Not so. It's there to give an idea of what he's capable with. But, you know, if I was going to create, let's say, someone like the Grey Mauser or Moonglum from the Elric stories, they don't fight with a sword and board. You know, the Grey Mauser, he has a rapier and a glaive. And he's a dual wieldist. I could replicate that quite easily with the appropriate combat style trait, the combat style, you know, two-handed weapons or dual wield, where I've got a rapier and a glaive. And what I would then do is make sure that I know which special effects I have got access to and which special effects will be most advantageous to support that style of fighting. So it's about using the rules and the tools that are in there to build the kind of approach that you want to have. If you want to be sort of straight down the road and go sword and board, absolutely fine. And the rules will give you that kind of optimum balance. But if you want to go out on a limb and do something more swashbuckling or something a bit outside the box, all the tools are there. You just mm-hmm. need to sit and think and look in there. You will find the support that you need for it.
Now, there were a few things that you had mentioned previously, but I'd like to ask what the future is holding for the design mechanism. Now, we already talked about casting the runes last time, but that's a gumshoe thing.
Yeah.
So, what I'm curious about is what you have in mind for the future of Mythras?
We have a pipeline that's set for the next couple of years. So it's more of the same. is what I can really say. We've got a number of releases that are imminent. Lioness, which is based on the Lioness trilogy by Jack Vance. Mm-hmm. That will be coming out in hopefully in the next week or so, by the end of April or the start of May. I'm hoping that's going to be available. So that's our big release for this year. Following hot on the heels, we have a fantasy city supplement called Fiora Cheetah, which is a fantasy version of a Renaissance Italian city state. So think Florence or Venice, you know, around the 1300s or 1400s, with lots of magic and weird races, and its own coherent sort of background in there. So that will be coming out later this year. I've already spoken a bit about the superhero game, which we're just reviewing the second version of the manuscript for that now. That's called Destined. That will be out for next year. We also have Mythic Polynesia in the works. That will be next year. Mythic Babylon, which we are assigning the artwork for now. That is fully edited. We then have some additions for Mythic Britain coming out. Pete is putting the final touches to his Mythic Greece supplement. So over the next 2 years, we've got a huge number. Oh, we have a spy book coming out as well, Department M. And that will replicate spies going from Jean Le Carrier all the way up to Matt Helm, if you want to go that daft. Mm-hmm. So we've got a ton of stuff that is on the cards for the next 2 years. And that's not even talking about the stuff that we're preparing for Classic Fantasy as well. We've got the Unearthed Companion, which is going to be the major expansion for Classic Fantasy. That will be next year. And there's a number of adventures and expansion books around that. You know, we've got an expansion for Alchemy. We've got an expansion for the Campaign World. Lots of different stuff that's going to be there for Classic Fantasy. So more of the same is really what I would say there, where we know what we're good at. We pride ourselves on doing very high quality content and production. We're getting better at that, and we just want to carry on doing what we do in the way that we do it.
All right. Now you've been at this for quite a bit, and
way too long, probably.
I'm pretty sure that analogy can apply to both of us. I know that a fair few people might watch some of the stuff on my channel and take that as the nudge or the eureka to want to try and branch out on their own when it comes to writing about role playing games. To those kind of people, what advice would you give them?
Do it. Give it a go. That's what I did. You know, I saw D&D. I wanted to have everybody house rules things. I did my own house rules, and I thought, hey, you know, I can write an adventure as good as that one. That's what I did. Do it. Try it. It's never been easier to be self-published, for one thing. It's never been cheaper. There have never been as many routes to market. We are genuinely in a golden age of role-playing games where they are no longer tucked in the corner as that embarrassing hobby no one ever talks about. Your RPGs are cool. There has never been a better time for you to follow that ambition if that's what you want. The ability to be able to put out your own game relatively easily to a pretty high standard of production as well is something that I could only have dreamed of when I was starting out. You know, this is back in the days where to make a character sheet look professional, you went out and bought letter set, you know, rub-on letters to do it. Mm. That's what you had to do. We have WordPress, with desktop publishing programs you can get for $50 now that are professional grade. Do it. Make sure that you've got a good idea about what it is that you want to achieve. It doesn't matter if it's a heartbreaker. It doesn't matter if it's a clone of D&D or Mythras or whatever, as long as you're not breaking any IP, trademark or copyright rules. But yeah, give it a go. Everybody makes mistakes. Everybody does things that they look back on and think, oh, shit, why did I do it that way? But you learn from those mistakes. Don't be disheartened. Carry on with it. Persevere with it. If you enjoy doing it, do it. And don't let anybody tell you otherwise.
All right. With that said, I do want to sincerely thank you for taking the time out of your schedule and braving the insanity that we had to deal when Skype decided it wanted to derp on us.
It did, didn't it? It was unforgiving.
Yeah. Well, that's why I'm trying to set the thing up a few minutes in advance, just in case something happens, because something always does. You know, the first casualty is always the battle plan.
Yep, no plan survives contact with the enemy.
And, well, to put it another way, according to the rules of combat that they don't teach you, no combat-ready unit ever passed inspection, and no inspection-ready unit ever passed combat.
Very true.
But, and of course, anytime you see fit to come back, and I promise you won't be some sort of sacrificial piece or something like that.
I was worried.
Anytime you feel like coming into the open bar of the internet, the door is always open to the temple.
That's very good to know. Thank you, Mildred.
Yep. And as we say on occasion here, drinking is not mandatory, but it is encouraged.
I will drink to that.
and of course, a sincere thanks to everybody else who took the time to tune in to this particular bout of insanity. And there will be more bits of crazy coming on the coming days, because just because we're all locked down doesn't mean the party stops. I'm not stopping the party until I see that roof flying. That's the way it goes around here. But until then, on behalf of the good brothers present and not present, my name is Mildra. I am your gaming monk. Stay fucking frosty, everybody.